have her poems about her divorce. Like, just how fucking typical, really.
There's also hints of different kinds of cloth.
Reality of what this actually is, we gotta start talking about.
Figured we could add James Newlick to our game because he would just slay them, but he'd completely disappeared, which, to be honest, wasn't that much of a surprise. Maybe after all these years, he finally tossed himself off his tower like he once tossed his typewriter off his dorm room floor. That key moment in his life when even his teacher at the time was like, Volman, who was in his early 30s at the time and had already published a couple groundbreaking works, was about to go on this polar expedition to research this. Volume 6 in the Seven Dreams series, which was a third book published after Volume 1 and Volume 2. It wasn't really that well known at the time, but still his work was already casting a shadow on younger contemporaries, Wallace, for instance, who operated out of a totally different set of concerns. Mainstream culture force-fed through these addictive input streams, you could practically predict the endgame of, at the same time disgusted by the academic circle jerk of American fiction and poetry of the 90s, causing him to regurgitate the postmodernism of the previous generation that he was supposedly so disdainful of. Volman didn't watch TV. Newlick, who this in his first novel, Distemper, which he now completely disowns, he calls it vile and satanic, and interestingly, this book was blurb by Volman. This is one of the few books to hold that distinction. And, you know, it's interesting to think of Volman, you know, just being as a writing teacher to anybody. In this case, more of a mentor. He's like 11 years older than James. They both lived in New York City at the time. And that was before James's fall from grace in a way, because he threw his typewriter out of his dorm room window and got expelled from college. And after that point, Volman kind of advised him to become a male prostitute. And you can kind of see James taking up the advice of Volman in his life, just maybe even taking it further, as he has this tendency of doing. And but also the influence of Volman in his writing. There's few writers that were even younger than Volman that could fully synthesize what Volman was doing. And it's really interesting to read other work through that prism. And I wouldn't really say it's like the pyrotechnics of a book like You Bright and Risen Angels, which is Volman's first novel, and which he himself also disowns, even though he says that pyrotechnics was really the whole point of the novel, that he just really wanted to see how far he could take it. But then he shifts into this more like reportage style, which he then became known for, at least one strand of his work, and it's really cool to see that shift, that sort of breaking of style happening within a single work, his very first. And yeah, but I kind of think like the Rainbow Stories, the color is more this book, the nitty-gritty dark realism of this book, where just like in James's own life, you don't really question, for instance, certain seedy scenes in this book. I think Wallace relies more on his abilities as a mimicry artist. You don't even question that with James. This book, which is about a 30-year-old school teacher and his love affair with a 13-year-old boy who he's the legal custodian of, and you get all these blow-by-blow details in this I guess you could say not too standard configuration, but it reminds me of the work of Dennis Cooper and James Purdy, actually. It's like this sort of violent, pedophilic homoeroticism that is just cranked to fever dream-like levels. Yeah, even though this book was published the same year that the endless entertainment ideas of Wallace started to come true, there were still these large canvas practitioners pulling out hard work at the time, but you also started to see these young, hungry writers reporting straight from the hell within, some less autistically than others. Because he was trying to get away from maybe some of the overcooked metaphors in his first book, which I actually kind of enjoy, for instance, a dude's shit-covered drawers clinging to his ass like a rosary. Dude flipped the script so hard in this book, his second novel. This is book as Suicide Note, where the narrator is in this Hotel Valencia, and he's ready to end his own life. He's flipping through photographs, just all the key memories in his universe, like smoking crack and contracting HIV, or almost getting abducted by this young man in a truck, riding around with his adoptive father who owned this junkyard and would take his son to the aftermath of accidents where you'd see like mangled cars and flesh just yielding up these secrets in the trunks in the form of pornography. Pictures of which he would cut out, not of girls though, but of these guys that he'd stick in his back pocket. And one day, his father asked him, oh shit, father asking him point blank in front of a customer if he was gay. And but not only that, just this constant search for his identity had this mixed race heritage, which somehow it resulted in him having these Asian looking eyes for which he was teased, but also having a lazy eye condition, kind of like his mentor Volman, who appears in Valencia and as a character. And, you know, that's the thing about this book. It's pretty much a memoir or autofiction, which is sort of like the shifting away from, you know, the tools of neo-postmodernists and just what else was going on in the world here. You can see like books like Montauk. This is a documentation of the author's liaison with the young American woman. I think this book will probably outlast some of his more creative efforts. We have Coetzee just serving up delicious bitch slaps at his own face. And Edward LeVay, this is a book that I think came out right before his last one, Suicide, which I unfortunately made a reality. And this book is just like a random stringing together of fact after fact in his life without any regard for story or structure. But in the case of Valencia, you know, this idea of transparency not yet being, well, it actually has been co-opted by corporations of just being honest and transparent. But the risk there is you end up not liking what you see. It's sort of like every cell within this panopticon that you're within is part of this larger body that you're piecing back together. Memory's like broken glass, but you're not getting cut up too much because of this warm, fleshy style that has you going so far down memory lane that you end up face to face with this dead pharaoh you thought you'd never see again. The next leap forward, I think, would be artists that don't even produce, but it would just be like secret dreamers just silently living their art. And that's like the perfect remedy to the question we always ask ourselves. Then we'd have complete control of the narrative where we could pull the ending in closer at any time. Wouldn't every day be more heavy?
A dead body, you can't do anything, you can't touch stuff, you can't eat stuff. Even if they get mad, that doesn't mean that you have to leave your family, because you always get used to it, because your family still loves you. And good about surviving is that you also have a ton of fun. You also get to play fun games with your family. Even if they get mad, that doesn't mean that you have to leave your family.